one, and the busy beaver to build them had almost disappeared from Canada. But the beaver, who will always be associated with Canada's early days, has been reintroduced into many areas and has made successful comeback. The beaver builds dams because he has to store his winter's food in water deep enough not to freeze. With all the woodcutting that the beaver has to do, it's fortunate that his incisor teeth never stop growing. For a more complete story of the beaver, why not contact the Canadian Wildlife Service in Ottawa?
There was a time dogs provided an essential service to society with activities such as fire service and rescue. With the introduction of crossbreeds such as the Labrador, this is no longer the case. The Labrador spends much of his day laying around on hardwood, carpets, and other surfaces. Many things go unnoticed by the Labrador in his deep slumber. Even dinner provides ample opportunity for rest and relaxation after a long day of laying around. For a more complete story of the Labrador, why not contact Canadian Wildlife Service in Ottawa?
We really enjoyed making that.
Yeah.
So, all the side effects are my kids making little bird sounds and all that. So, anyway, if you have nothing better to do over the holiday season, show somebody Hinterland Who's Who and make an episode. Anyway, back to the fun stuff. And there's a few things in the less than 2 hours we have left that I want to show you. Realm assessment, we might get a chance to talk a little bit about grading. But here's the point. So back to my buddy in chemistry. One of the problems I'm into was this idea of, do you want to grade assignments when you're unsure who did them? And you might be like, yeah, no, I really like that. And in that case, I would suggest buying a shirt. I grade identical homework assignments, I hate my spare time. That's kind of how I felt, anyway, when I would have students hand in, I don't know if you've ever had this yourself, but they hand in these assignments, very, very similar answers to them, and you can begin to see who copied off who by spelling mistakes made, whatever. That got a little bit irritating. So I'm a big fan of an idea that maybe we just stop doing something, and that is, I propose we stop grading identical assignments done outside of our country. Just throwing it on the table. Because I think we're just incentivizing plagiarism, incentivizing maybe copying off one another. So I'm a big, big fan of what my colleague and friend Ben R. Curry does in his chemistry class. And it's also an ongoing assessment model. So here's how it works. Instead of grading homework, Ben has built an entire system of in-class quizzes. And what he does is he gets his students to plan their evenings ahead of time for what homework they think they need to do. Is it having an impact on their understanding? Well, what we really want to do is have students see a connection between effort exerted on their own time. And does that play a role in increased achievement? That's the chemistry, Ben's going to go through a certain set of equations, they're going to understand it, they're going to do a lab, they're going to practice some of those. And then he might say, here's some questions I would suggest you try at home to further your understanding, because you're going to get assessed on this tomorrow to see where you're at. So Katie is going to put down, these are the page numbers and questions, and the question we're trying to get students to explore is, when do you plan on doing that? Because I realized I just turned 50, November 7th, and I'm still trying to figure out how to organize my evening, and I to look ahead, I plan accordingly and know what I'm going to do. It wouldn't hurt for students to take pause for a second and go, okay, I've got the girls' volleyball practice from 3:30 to 5:30, I've got to go home and do this. So what Ben encourages students to do is to literally jot down, when do you think you can find 30 minutes to look at this evening when you start looking ahead? So that's the purpose of this document you see right here. So what she done, homework assignments or whatever, home learning, and she checks off whether or not she did it. What Ben does is he has a tracking sheet for students to track how well they did on in-class quizzes. So when students are encouraged to do homework, Ben's going to say, the second chemistry class tomorrow, I'm going to have a check-in quiz on this, and it's based on the homework assignment that I'm suggesting. So students will take a very short quiz, and then what is Ben's ongoing assessment system? There's a re-quiz for each one of these quizzes. So instead of his being like mine, in loop of quizzes that students can check their understanding on, but if Ben was standing here right beside me, he would say, I don't have a retest. Right here it says chapter 2 test, and there is no retest below it. That's it. He said, but students can do as many practice quizzes out, and those are the exact kinds of questions they're going to get on their tests, so students can check on their learning all the time. So that, when I said there, I was going to share three examples of an ongoing assessment system done in a high school, there's my system, Rachel's system, and then Ben runs this, which is a system based around quizzes and homework suggestions. And he loves it. He's been doing it for probably going on 8 years now. In his class, with a 75-minute chemistry class, Ben would have about 8 to 10 minutes at the end of class for students to get a start on their homework, do a quiz or a re-quiz, because he virtually offers endless quizzes for students to check on their understanding of chemistry-type equations. So, and I know Ben really well, and I've seen his system a million times. If there's somebody who's got a question on something that maybe I didn't make perfect sense of, it's right after lunch, are there any questions about what I just presented on his ongoing assessment system? Yeah, Sid?
Does the second quiz have a question from the first quiz?
The second quiz can be modeled very closely on the first, but they're not identical. Oh, do they add up in like content point of view? What he does here is he has them by, if I go back for just a second. He's got his topics right here. It's Sid, right? He's got his topics here. Dynamic equilibrium, characteristics of equilibrium, spontaneous and non-spontaneous. So he has them divided by topic, if you will. So I don't think they add to themselves in that way, unless I just don't understand his chemistry method there. I may not be answering that question accurately, but you can see there, here's the topics he's got. So jumping ahead just ever so slightly to this, I just wanted to skip those bills. Here's Shona. Shona is a biology and math teacher at Summerland Secondary. Both of my kids have been through her class. We've been working on something that's interesting. One of the unavoidable questions, I think, when it comes to ongoing assessment is, what about student responsibility? What about sometimes teachers feeling like, if I offer retests or whatever, it feels like I'm doing most of the effort and the work, and maybe students are not taking it seriously or not doing their part. I want to share a concept with you that you might find useful, even if you tweak it. Shona came up with a retest application. Her and I came up with it together when we realized So I'll show you some of the things, and we have it, it's on Word available to you. If you want to tweak it a little bit or change it entirely, go ahead. But you'll see here that you have the name, the unit, and the date. She has some learning goals or activities the student wants to revisit. And what they do is they can self-assess on emerging, developing, proficient, or extending. But I, more importantly than most things, I really like the questions that are embedded on this. So what went wrong the first time you took this assessment? What would you do differently? Have you completed every video activity, lab, discussion, paragraph, or quiz? You simply check off yes or no. And if it's no, can you please explain that decision? Page 2. You'll notice our attempt to get rid of the word work. Do you practice, prepare, or learn outside of our class, such as at home, on your spare, or at lunch? Yes or no? Number 7, I really like from a student self-reporting question. It reads, how would you describe your approach to learning, such as effort, participation, use of class time, and collaboration, to get students to articulate that or at least consider it? So in other words, the message here is, before we run around doing all these things, are you doing some of the absolute basics? And really what this document is designed to do is to start down the path of that conversation. So we found it to be really useful for that purpose. And it's a suggestion, you don't have to do it, but we have a place for a student signature there, which explains a little bit about the retesting process. And in certain cases, we ask for a parent signature if we believe that the situation warrants it or we think that would help. In some cases, it doesn't help. It'd be better to keep the parent out of it because of an adversarial relationship there. But I thought maybe you would like to see this around reassessment and an application form. At least 4 people came up to me so far and said, this thing you talk about, this performance versus learning, I'm kind of interested. You kind of talked about it briefly with, I think it was Jesse's unicycle, performance versus learning. I included this in a folder today called Extras. If you want to read their article, I included a chapter from the book Psychology of Everyday Life, and it's written by Elizabeth and Robert Bork from UCLA. And the article, as you see here, is called Making Things Hard on Yourself But in a Good Way, Creating Desirable Difficulties to Enhance Learning. It's a really good article on 4 things you can do that add struggle to learning but are backed by research and show to be effective in increasing achievement and understanding. So one of the 4 is practice testing. That people don't necessarily like it, but it leads to greater learning. A little teaser from this is using tests rather than presentations. Bork and Bork write that basically any time you as a learner look up an answer or have somebody tell or show you something that you could have figured out for yourself, you rob yourself of a powerful learning opportunity. Much laboratory research has demonstrated the power of tests as learning events, and in fact, a test or retrieval attempt, even when no corrective feedback is given, can be considerably more effective in the long term than reading material over and over again. They finish it exactly how I felt when I started this. Assessment means testing to me. Look at their very last point. Unfortunately, the effectiveness of tests as learning events remains largely underappreciated, in part because testing is typically viewed as a vehicle of assessment, not a vehicle of learning. So this is a really, really good article if you want to go a little deeper down the rabbit hole on making things hard on yourself, but in a good way. Recently, I've designed a session around these 3, around reassessment. And sometimes schools come up with policies around reassessment. For example, student in our school has the right to a reassessment of any assessment.
You're going to go back to the slide I shared earlier. Not a big fan of policy. I don't think that's going to get you out of your problem. That sounds like a policy to me.
I want to throw some ideas down around agreements. Agreements over policy. I would say to any group, do we agree that learning takes time and more time can result in more learning? We learn from our mistakes, at least I tried to. And more mistakes can actually result in more learning. There's evidence to suggest that. So then finally, our goal is for all students to strive for their best. For some of them, that's mastery. And for us to acknowledge it. So in other words, I want to acknowledge that somebody has gotten better on the unicycle, and I want my assessment data to reflect where they are on the unicycle right now and acknowledge that growth. Not keep an assessment from 2 weeks ago that I don't think is relevant anymore. So I want to throw that on the table, and I'm wondering if from an ongoing assessment point of view, just to recap, my test retest system, Rachel's practice test, Ben's quiz system, not grading homework, and finally, the retest application form, is that something to consider as well? So I'm going to give you a little bit of time. It's just after lunch. You can chat for a bit, and then maybe something like 7 minutes, around 2 o'clock, I want to tackle something called wiping our window of assessment to look at two alternative assessment ideas I'd like to share. So take a little time just to discuss this notion of ongoing assessment. We'll reconvene at 2.
Thank you.
anybody thinks it, it's not lost on me that a room with 150 to 170 people isn't always the greatest to debrief and share. I want everybody to know that if you're wondering something about this moving forward, ByronDewitt@gmail.com is my email address. You can find it on my website, ByronDewitt.com. Always feel free to reach out. If you say, hey, you were at our school, I tried something, you got time for Zoom, do a Zoom call for 5 or 10 minutes? The answer is yes, okay? You don't have to go to your administration, find money or anything, just contact me and let's chat. So I want you to know I'm thinking that even when I stop and say, hey, does anybody have a question about this? I know this isn't a great forum for that, so I try to offer both. A large scale conversation, you can always contact me on the back channel as well. So with that said, did anybody have a question or a comment, a clarification? Daryl, is it? I have not used that retest form ever. I have never, Daryl, been able to explain the cultural differences from class to class that I've had, okay? I can have a class where the culture of ongoing assessment kind of catches on, and if I offer retests at lunch, half the class should take one. The next one, teaching the same course to the same age group in my school, no one shows up at lunchtime if I offer it. If I knew the difference, my Learjet would be at the airport probably to determine exactly why this occurs. I put the retest piece up there, that retest application. I put it up there because there are some teachers who go, what do you do if I have a bunch of students who are kind of taking advantage of the system and not really owning it? That's one idea. Is that fair enough? Yeah. Oh, and by the way, the younger the students, or the more at risk the students are, the less likely I am to run retests outside of class time. So my grade nines, I run my retests in class, and any type of class like the one I shared about that had a number of struggling learners in it, yet running retests at lunch or after school. And no one's gonna show up, like basically no one. So we're inside of class time, and I know that eats up some of my ability to crunch. All right. So at lunchtime, we were talking about a game. I don't know how this came up. At lunchtime, we were talking about a game that I ran when I was teaching my high school class. I ran it in grade 12. A guy told me to do this. If students have a hard time getting to class after lunchtime, I would put a song on. The moment the bell rings, I put on a song. The duration of that song, I had like 5 review questions up there. Students could look at their notes, they could ask the person beside them, they were like factual kind of yes or no questions, and then I would take all the papers, and anybody who was there for the game is eligible to win. I would go through them, we would throw out, my grade 12 students got a paperclip. Okay? That's the reward, paperclip. And at the end of the year, you got students that have this dangling list of paperclips, and they would flick them and be all proud of them. So I became a fan of playing some kind of game after lunch. So, today we're playing a game. We're going to play a game where you can win something. And I forgot them at home, but I'm going to ship them. Okay? My friend started this company in Summerland called Maple Rock. Organic maple syrup. And I think one of the best things they do are these Maple Rockies they're called. Package of maple candies made from organic maple syrup, and they're like a lozenge or something. So, we're going to play a game. It's called Heads or Tails. Come on, Stan. Anybody in on the game? Hey, now, we're going to have to police each other on this and be honest, okay? If you want to choose heads, you put your hand on your head. If you want to choose tails, guess what? On your tail. My students love this game also. I still think it's... If we make a decision, I say locked. I'm going to flip this coin. What's your name? Sam. Sam is going to be my witness so long as... I just need to enough people around to verify this, and I'll tell you if it's heads or tails. If you're correct, you stay in the game. If you're incorrect, you sit down. The last person standing in this game gets the maple candy sent to them. Okay? By yours truly. All right? Okay, so make a decision. Heads or tails, Sam and the people at this table are going to verify that this truly is a Canadian movie. See any problems with it? All right, make your decision. Oh, house rule, because this comes up in my class all the time. Should the coin fall to the floor, it's a reflip, I will catch it and put it on my hands. The only way that it's a valid toss. Okay? Right on its edge, I'm going to catch it and put it on my wrist. See? What's this? Here we go. Make the decision. I have to go to someone who's not that. Heads. Heads. So you can change, obviously, now. You can go heads or tails. It's up to you. All right. Make your decision. Other one. Definitely not. But there's a change to the one that some of you have seen called Walkabout. It's seen us take another step. So here we go. This is going to fit into maybe both of these, but really it fits into just widening the window of assessment. Okay, remember that slide I showed, like widen the window? That's what we're going to try to do here. Another thing that we're going to look at, reminded of Laszlo Bock's line. What was the very last point? What do we want? Students who like figuring out stuff where there's no obvious answer. So that's going to fit into this section. The other thing I want to remind people of is that university two-stage exam kind of idea. So, Marcus Blair. Marcus Blair is an English teacher at Summerland Secondary. He also teaches psychology and some social studies. Both my kids have had him as a teacher. Both like him and all that sort of thing. It's an interesting class. Marcus sent me an email during COVID, and it read something like this. It was like, grade 11 and 12 teacher likes the student scale. All right, especially the extending. It allows students who want to go further and explore on their own to just go for it. All right, so why do you like that? Different. What he particularly likes about inquiry questions is focus. So maybe halfway through a course, maybe the end of the course, maybe the very beginning of the course, students are able to select from the boxes and make a question that appeals to them for them to study with some structure, right? So, how does, what am I going to study here? Oh, social media. A verb, anyone? Just harm, damage. You notice how you start to form a question here by the verb you choose? So maybe I go influence. Influence what? How does social media influence Russia, foreign policy, the environment, democracy, the very process of elections? Somebody else in class chooses, how can increasing literacy rates impact women's rights movements? What we do is we put spaces in here that if students say, hey, you're missing a sentence starter, you're missing a verb, you're definitely, in my opinion, missing a few things in there, boom. It's called inquiry pizza, and you jump from menu to menu item to make a question. And we've had a lot of success with this. Let me show you some examples from other places as well. Marcus did this in his philosophy class, and he found even for his grade 12 students, you really had to scaffold it. He just goes in order. How might TikTok impact my well-being? For one of the first times in my life, I looked at a new assessment tool, and my own son was in this class in grade 12. I go, Elijah, what'd you pick? Let me guess. He goes, go ahead, Dad, guess. How does Family Guy, and he goes, yeah, you're right so far. I'm like, illustrate community. He goes, oh, yeah. He's a Family Guy watcher, and he was showing me the clip from Family Guy where they're trying to park the boat down the boat launch. Anybody has seen that? You don't have to like Family Guy to appreciate the boat launch scene. And I laughed so hard. I said, Dad, is that not what the Summerline Bolt launch is like? Exactly. So anyway, how does Family Guy illustrate community? And so it just took off from there. I was in Glenbard, Chicago. Their math department went with, put in your own problem here if you want, most consistent NFL place kicker, minutes of YouTube per month, whatever. How could I determine how many tiles cover our school floor using area and estimation? Their math department uses this as the absolute introductory piece to math. Choose something in the first week that you'd like to solve, and we'll solve it. That's how we start the course. My own way to calculate most consistent kicker is, that's Matt Kapoor's research around first tackle the problem, then learn standard deviation. And I got this tweet or direct message from Allie in Victoria. She said, I saw this inquiry pizza thing on your website. I love it. Can I show you what I did? Absolutely. She did a social justice literature book study. Sentence starters, actions and verbs. There's the menu. And then she did this, and I thought it was a fantastic skit. Once students had taken their read their social literature book, they came up with their question on a sticky note, and then they, based on the menu, then they come up in front of the class and they put all of their sticky notes on the whiteboard. And as a class, they begin to look and see what the themes are that people are coming up with. So for example, friendship, discrimination, propaganda, human rights, Where are the themes here? So they have a class conversation about this, and people can look at other people's questions and tweak theirs a little bit to say, oh, I kind of like the angle you're going with that, or I'd like to do this. And that becomes the quest of your unit project. And the first time Allie did this, she asked people to illustrate their question on a poster using books and social media as backup to your idea. Where are you seeing influences for your question? So here's what they look like. How you can see the question here in the middle. How might appearance affect equality? You can choose song, you can choose image, you can choose story. Illustrate what is, what's kind of coalescing to get you to answer that question. Or the question, how might the isms impact everyday life? And you can see it's the Outsider's book, Spin Me Right Round, lyrics, and so on. And this person studying, focusing on Viola Desmond, the question, and how does racism impact self-image? So it's just a way, I thought I would share today, that we're trying to address this idea of there's no obvious answer. How do you take the curriculum and still make it personal for a student quest? So I am totally open to anybody in this room like, hey, I like that idea. I'm thinking about designing it for my class. You may do so. Feel free to reach out. I've had teachers from Delaware and the Yukon and say, hey, check it out. I did this inquiry thing. A woman in Delaware wrote me and said it's the best collection of Great Gatsby essays she has ever had. And instead of her choosing the theme from the Great Gatsby, students choose their own theme from a menu and connected through the Great Gatsby novel that they're taking as class. If you want to read a bit more on this, it's on my website called the Inquiry Pizza Project. I think it's called, yeah, Pizza Inquiry Project. But hey, turn to the person beside you. You can fake it and talk about something else, right? Olga will likely be discussing these candies she's getting in the family. But if you want to take a little bit of time, take a few minutes and also, what do you think about this Inquiry Pizza idea? Then we're going to book a walkout.
Thank you.
working my way around the room here a little bit. Sound like there might be some interest in some circles, at least just taking thinking and so on in a direction. Don't hesitate to reach out if you're trying something here. I'd love to hear about it. As you can see, I share other people's thoughts and ideas when they're willing to say, hey, here's what I did for my class, and that's how we share. Sharing is caring, the way I see it. So let's flip the page to something that has kind of taken off in our district a little bit, certainly in places I've shared it. I shared the first version of this when I was here last time, but it has morphed something for us, and I want to share that part too. So it doesn't matter if you saw this before, you're gonna rewind back to the beginning and say, here's kind of how it started. So one thing to take off from here is this. Universities. Some departments have begun using two-stage exams, the first stage being individual, the second stage being group. Now, what a lot of these universities are doing, just so you know, the activity is group-based. Your assessment is your reflection of that group experience. So you're not still not grading you based on what somebody else did, but more your experience within that. So this all started with something called Walkabout. My friend Russ was pursuing a question. So try this question on for size, okay? He said, Myron, I'm pursuing an inquiry question in my own practice, and it's this. Why do I take these things away when my students are being assessed? Like, he says, do you, Myron? I said, I always take phones away for like my History 12 test or whatever. That's what I always do. And why? Well, anyone? Cheating. I mean, cruel, mean, and uncaring. That's the first one. That's what I have. Cheating, yeah.
Distraction.
Plagiarism, looking something up and taking that as an idea. It's all those things, right? And I said, wouldn't that be reason enough for us to take the phones away? He said, yeah, but there's something artificial about that for me. What do you mean? He said, well, they have those things in their pockets all the time. Isn't there something artificial about an assessment that you must give up something you always have in your pocket, but any other day of the week, you got that thing with you? At first, I was pretty dismissive of his question, but then it kind of was gnawing at my brain. It's like, and he finally said, like, maybe this is a sign that we need to change. Huh. So, took him about a half year. He was approaching the final exam in his grade 12 human geography course, and he says, I'm going to try it. So I think I got my idea. So here it is. It's called Walkabout. He is going to finish his course by giving students one of nine concepts they've taken in class. What the students will then do, and he told them this, day two of your exam, you guys need to bring a decent pair of shoes because we're taking a 30-minute walk. We have a two-hour walk for our exam, and the first 30 minutes is a stroll outside the school. Down this street, over to that one, and back again. So students say, whatever you want, what's the purpose of the walk? We'll find out tomorrow, just be prepared to take. So, on that walk, when the students get to class, he says, okay, you're going to choose one of nine concepts. We're going to take a 30-minute walk. While you're on that walk, you need to capture a digital image of something that is a manifestation of the concept you have chosen, that you see it in the photo. And when we get back, what you're going to do is you're going to support your decision. So, there's a triangulation effect here. Lots of teacher structure, but student choice at every corner of the triangle. Okay? You might still be like, Myron, can I see what you mean? Absolutely. So this is in your handout. Russ gives his class this documentation. Please select two of the nine quotes or statements below. So here's the nine statements. Pollution knows no borders. Population growth is a primary source of environmental damage. The future will either be green or not. Take a picture from our community that reflects your quote. Your you're going to write 200 to 250 words per quote and be really clear on how they connect, include topics from our course. If Russ was standing here and he says it was a stretch for them to do two in one block, I might switch that to one, not two. That's one of the things he probably adjust. He sends me this photo. Russ, why are you sending me a photo of students sitting there? He said, because it's 30 minutes after our exam is supposed to have been over, and I have people turning to me going, just wait, I'm almost there. And they're engaged. They want to complete this thing in a meaningful way. So here's the type of examples he was getting. So this student chose the concept urbanization and industrialization have had extremely degrading impacts on the environment. This person took a picture of a fast food cup beside the road, and then she went off. The idea of a $6 burger and fountain pop beverage sounds great when living on a budget, as most are, but it's a flaw in the system, as the poor can't afford healthy organic options. The idea of fast food is all around gross. We idle in a car, pumping fossil fuels in the atmosphere as we await a beef burger made only with the utmost variable hormones and extremely high levels of water usage. As we talk to someone making minimum wage in a province run by a government working for those at the top. Yes, the system is flawed. There. Hey, you like that? Look at her very last sentence. But hey, how's the economy? Sorry, I forgot to ask. So, what Russ began to see, here's another student that said, where are we walking? And Russ told them they're out there walking. She goes, well, I know a photo I'm taking. Before they ever left the class, the student says, I walk that road to school. I know what I'm taking a picture of. And she just kept her phone in her pocket until they got to this mural. And she snapped a picture of a mural that's in one of the back alleys in Penticton. And she saw the question, and she said, it's not that we inherited from our forefathers, we inherited from our mothers. And she wrote about that concept with that image and just put in support pieces like millennials and the importance of the environment and Mother Earth and all these pieces. And where this really took us, everybody, was to a question, another question, and it was this. Russ says to me, I loved this year-end demonstration of learning in my human geography class. Loved it. And I said, but, I hear a but coming, Russ. Oh, yeah. But how do I assess it? Like, this is way outside the realm of what I normally do. And I said, have you seen the language that kindergarten to grade 9 is looking at with the four categories? I bet you're trying to grade this on a percentage system. He says, I am. It's really hard. I said, I think we should do it in a rubric. So introducing the rubric that Russ and I built for this project, here's how we built it. First of all, there's a description up here of the project and what they're supposed to do. But then I've really wrapped my head around this, you guys, that the criteria should be the two or three things, maybe four at most, that the person is supposed to do. So the criteria for us read, discuss a clear connection between the quote and the image. Demonstrate an understanding for how concepts from his Human Geography 12 enhance your connection. So now he's asking people to bring in details from the course. And thirdly, support your argument using relevant and accurate information. And I think you mentioned plagiarism, right? He'd say to students, use your phone. Look up data, look up research, look up whatever you want that's going to enhance your connection. I mean, what are the chances that someone can copy their response from somebody on the internet? A picture of Penticton within a block of our school and a concept given by the teacher. Good luck copying that off the internet somewhere. It can be really hard. So that's not a worry. Look up whatever you want. Now let's just talk verbs for a second. Discuss, demonstrate, support. I stole this idea from the Alberta Assessment Consortium when I was there. They were showing me their rubric development, and they kick off their criteria with a verb. I went back and looked at my rubrics. Most of my rubrics have a noun sitting there, topic sentence. nice to see because the person knows what to do. I recently had this experience on the tarmac at an airport. Okay? There's this gentleman walking ahead of me. He has a carry-on bag with him. There's a tag on it. And we get to the baggage handler on the side of the plane. It's really loud. And she says, "Baggage tag!" The guy's standing there, and I'm behind him. She goes, "Baggage tag!" She tries one more time, "Baggage tag!" Tap them on the shoulder and I say, "No problem, you needed a verb." I looked at her. And it's true. It's true. A verb once in a while helps us. So, start with a verb. Then what we did is we built the proficient language. Provides a meaningful connection, provides a practical understanding, provides considerable support. Copied it into the other columns and then just found the family of words that would be the progression where those bolded ones are. So here we go. Attempts a basic connection, provides an appropriate connection. It took us a little bit of time to come up with the right family of words, but I have a resource for you in a second that's really going to help for that. We moved to a no evidence box instead of a zero. If there's no evidence, we can check that box off and give it back to the student. We've been encouraged in BC to write to construct all levels in our rubric in strength-based terminology. Not deficit-based terminology, strength-based. At first, I wasn't too warmed up to this idea. Like, I was thinking, I had that voice in my head going, "Can't you just tell students where it's at?" Rather, it's attempts a basic, is beginning to demonstrate, attempting to support. Recently, because we just went through report card writing, we've been holding sessions for teachers on how to write strength-based report card comments that still indicate what a student needs to develop or progress on. So this is, I think, I'm going to share my personal opinion here, I'm really warming up to the idea. Because when we phoned up parents who we knew in the community who do not come to parent-teacher interviews, one of the number one we were given by those parents is because I don't like schools, they've never been a positive place for me. That's the parents. Because I don't know how many people in this room can relate to ongoing negative language for most of your educational career. It's usually negative. So I think there's something to be said here for turning rubrics to positive language or at least speaking to strengths. That said, there is a feature on this rubric where you can just use the way they are if that's what you want to do. It's coming up in a moment. The first thing is a checklist. I love this idea. You know how something's either in the assignment or not? It's not a measure of quality, it just needs to be there. So in this, have you included two images? Check. Three sources? Yep. Self-reported. Proofread. It's just a checkbox, and a student fills that in. Here's a place, like I was mentioning, for personalized comments. And finally, if you want it, there's an overall evaluation for a 1-2-3-4 scale, an emerging to extending scale. IB would use a 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8. This rubric is useful in so many different educational applications. So, that's it. Now, I have an opinion to ask yours. In your mind's eye, take a look at this rubric, all right? The walkabout rubric. If you had to choose, would you take this one or the version we've most recently constructed? What some people would call a single point or single column. Here it is. We kept the family of words, considerable and substantial. And what we've done is we've just put in grayscale, attempts to support, we got rid of this line, partial support, Yeah. What would be your leaning? This one? Or that one? Why? What do you like? What are there features you like about one or the other? What about this topic in general? Go. Oh, sorry. By the way, teacher or student can fill in the reasons why they believe they are where they are on this version. I'm sorry, I should have said that. It's for filling in. Go. So, very thankful to Sid, who years ago hailed the Canadian government for more information offer, and I now have a brochure for Hinterland Who's Who the Beaver. So, this has made my day, and Olga, you thought you would cash in on candies, like, look what I got, Hinterland Who's Who. Okay, any opinions one way or the other? Because we're gonna go down this road a little bit on these single point rubrics. Anybody have a leaning one way or the other? Whether it's that one or that one? Thoughts on? Darryl, what were you thinking? Staying out of this one? Okay. going through exemplars. What do you think this is? What do you think that is? Which word would you apply? So my recommendation would be to, you know, I know staff meetings are typically full of riveting, interesting information, which I'm sure it is here, but we're looking at maybe how do we use a bit of that time for even departments to sort out, say, could we come to some agreement on what this might look like? This exploration, let me show you some of the things that are happening in our school. Here's one of them. What we're doing is we're getting students at, I'm going to make this a little bigger. I really, if I go back, I'm sorry, let me go back for a second. This is made by Marcus Blair. He has the BC standard up above, where I'd like to grow. He calls beginning and developing proficient, which he embeds the criteria in this column. I really like this. And then sophisticated. And what he asks his students to do is as they submit their piece of writing, he asks them to comment where they believe they're at in their writing using this single point rubric. So if I make this a little bigger, you'll see the student over here on the right. I did not stray from first person. I created a powerful story. And over here, I tend to ramble on in my sentences. My diction is sometimes too simple and then unnecessarily complicated in others. She's reflecting on her writing. I know this student, very, very capable writer. I also know this student, who is not as accomplished a writer, but you can see that he's getting into reflecting on his writing in ways that I certainly didn't do in high school. When he writes, I would like to use more connections in my writing so that the reader can relate to my experiences. It's a good point. So we have found that this single column rubric kind of opens the door for student self-reflection and giving some structure to do so. Now, every once in a while, something will land on my desk, usually from Marcus Blair in our school, saying, look at this. So Marcus came by my office one of my last days at Summerline Secondary, and he puts this on my desk. I'm going to make it a little bigger. I'm just going to, from wherever you are sitting, hopefully you can see this thing already, would you just ponder for a moment with somebody beside you just looking at this? I'm going to scroll here. What the heck is this student actually doing? Because I said to Marcus, was this an assignment you gave them or something? He said, no. This was the student filling out their own single column rubric using these highlights. So just take a swing at this for a minute or two. What the heck is this person doing? Try to explain. You're welcome to get up and walk closer if you want to see it. Thank you. timing thing, the order in which it was done. Did Joel get there? Is there anybody else in here that was hearing about? No? Okay, right over here, and then I'm going to Mitchell. If we ever get to Mitchell, that's fine. Just kidding, Mitchell is a joke.
All right, so at the top, it looks like they've actually gone down to a finer point scale and put their marks on the slider. And if you notice, some of them seem to cross and span multiple boxes, and they put comments there where it deviates from the proficient for that particular criteria.
So that kind of crunched out scale at the top of the colors?
Yeah.
Okay. Mitchell, happy to come over. Here you go.
And building on what Tyson said there, they've highlighted this, each of the specific expectations there, and they're actually placing each individual specific expectation where they feel they are on that one, plus linking to that continuum on top.
Anybody else? So I say to Marcus, the English teacher, so who is this? Anyway, we have a high school, not SRSS size. We have 420 students at Summerland Secondary School. And I'm like, so who is this? And he goes, that's Dirk. Dirk, first of all, there's only one Dirk in our school. And secondly, and how many Dirks would there be at SRSS? Just see if this scales. Any? So you have no Dirks at all. We'll run up on you then. We have a Dirk. So Dirk, and I coached Dirk in volleyball last weekend, switched to swimming, just couldn't do both. I know Dirk. I go up to Dirk and go, hey Dirk, I saw your single column rubric with the colors. Hey, hey. I said, would you do me a favor, Dirk? Sure. Hey, go, come on. I said, I present to teachers all the time on this. I've been trying to figure out your system. Would you explain your system in a minute or less as to what you're up to? And video me, and I can video it, send it by video, and I can use it in my presentation. Are you in? Sure, I'll send it to you. So let's have Dirk explain what he's up to. All right, Dirk. Now, as Dirk speaks, I'm going to point out some things he's talking about. Please appreciate the slide. It takes 3 hours to build. Okay, here we go.
So what I would do is that I would highlight the prompt that the teacher gave me and then place it within one of the four categories, labeled beginning, developing, proficient, and sophisticated. So for example, if one of the prompts was, I can use transition words within my writing piece, I would highlight that and place it in one of the columns that I believe corresponded to that prompt within my writing. So if I thought I did poorly, I would put it in the developing or beginning column. And if I think I did great, I would put it in the sophisticated column. I would color code that and give a little explanation as to why.
Well, there you have it. So, for you Bugs Bunny fans out there, there's always the Acme catalog of tools. I'm a big believer that change is a little easier if we have the tools for change. So, as we shift in our proficiency scale language, this resource I'm about to show you has been super popular. And it's a resource that helps teachers determine families of words, and if I'm building a rubric, I definitely have this open, because sometimes you just can't think of a word. So here it is. We've built a rubric support document that has families of words that we believe fit into these categories. So here you might say few, initial, may, all the way over to captivates, pertinent, and fully engages the reader. Those sorts of things. It's been really helpful. The feedback I got from teachers in our district and elsewhere on this document has been really, really positive. Especially of all people, first it was our elementary teachers in our district, but the high school teachers who are going to be engaging in this have really warmed up to it. You know, they're writing report card comments, and sometimes, here's what we've been trying with our report card comments. I know I'm like all over the place right now. What's a strength the student has? What's an area they need to grow in? And what's a next step that is tangible and doable and specific that they could do? So strength, stretch, next step. That's what we want in our report comments. Not that have a great summer isn't really valuable, but and lovely to hear, but every once in a while, we're trying this, right? We're trying to have this. So when we are writing the next step, we thought, wouldn't sentence starters be handy? So here's the second page. In familiar situations can, with support, is sometimes able to. But here's the thing. When we're encouraging somebody to take a next step, if they are here on their report card, this column is really, really good to come up with next step suggestions. So if you sometimes are able to, the next step to work on is to consistently provide examples of. It's just been really, really handy for writing report card comments, talking with parents, and coming up with suggestions for students. So this rubric word bank is sitting there at your disposal if you want it. So I know that you guys are going to I'm hoping that today provides some ideas of maybe what you could develop, what you could learn continually on, and so on. So a couple little stops along the way here. Here's one more of them before we just talk about a few grading things and self-reporting. Here's your opportunity for a few minutes. 5 minutes at 3:15, we're going to finish off with a few more pieces I wanted to share. The question is, would this be a direction to consider with the colleagues that you're sitting next to? Rubric development, this word bank. What do you think about those single column rubrics where students would fill out or you would give comments? So here's a 5 minute opportunity before we get to our closing at 3:15 for you to have this conversation, okay? Go.
Thank you.
Okay. So, you know, I did keep this last section for whatever time, like, we had time for. That's great. And this involves, like, the, I don't know, anything from zeros to late deductions to a few more things on homework. Clearly, I don't have tons of time, but I thought I would maybe give a little sampling of some things. But I am totally open. Any question from the floor or to say, hey, here's something that we're talking about in our department, or how do you feel about this or that? I don't want someone to walk out the door not getting a chance to say, you know, if we're going to discuss grades or another question about any of the things we've done today, you're not going to hurt my feelings by asking a tough question or a wonderment, okay? So you're totally welcome to do so. Targets, I built a retesting system, looked at rubrics, and then slowly but surely kind of came around to questioning some of the grading decisions I had been making. And those quite literally centered around these three things. And all I can speak to is my own experience, but what I tried to do and more or less did it cold turkey was I just stopped grading homework. I don't want to call it homework anymore. I'm going to change that to I stopped grading learning done at home. For reasons I've already expressed, I didn't know who's doing it. I can't control students' homes. So I'm just going to stop grading that. I stopped reducing scores for what are we going to call it? Late submission of learning. I just didn't see the connection anymore. Say, sitting down at a parent-teacher interview, saying to a parent, oh, your daughter's a really, really good social studies student, but a few things have been handed in late, so she's got this lower grade. I mean, she's either doing well in the social studies standards or she's not. And I don't know why I'm bringing the grade down because things are late. I wish they were on time, but I'm going to try to avoid grading down for that. And lastly, stop using zero for evidence of learning not handed in. I tried really, really hard to get away from that, just to try alternatives. So, I knew we had Ken O'Connor's book laying around our school for a while, and I never really cared to read it until I had done all these other things, and only after designing unit plans and then assessments that match those unit plans did I say to myself, and I'm going to use this word for me, not for you, why am I going to corrupt my data by these behavioral things? So that's kind of where I landed on. And I think it's a really important part of my journey, at least coming to this. And if you want my opinion one more time of how I think I largely solved this conundrum, it's going back to this. Earlier today I showed this slide. At the moment I think my grades became a lot less blurry. And I do have the opportunity to visit schools all over the place. And once in a while, I'll bump into a school where if you go to their website, this is a Catholic school that I've been a part of in the United States, name there, such and such a school assigns grades in order to communicate the level of a student's academic achievement. It's a really, really good mission statement to have. Clear to everybody, what do your grades represent? And I think this fits really well with some of the lead writers, if you will, in this area. This article by Bailey and McTighe simply states that student achievement. And that student achievement, I would say, would be according to or against the required curriculum of that area. So this is what I've tried to do. And with that, they go to communicate about a student's habits, because this is academic standards. Rather, student's effort, conduct, responsibility, punctuality, behavior, the processes by which a student learns are reported in a separate habits of scholarship grade. So what I know of SRSS with your separate behavioral element, I really encourage that. I think that's fits into an assessment plan. So I wanted to share a thing or two about homework, and I'm going to continue. I want to share a little bit about homework and at least two things that I think have really helped our school before we're out of time. Okay, here's one of them. When we were making this shift in our high school, maybe you have something like this, I don't know, I should have asked. We have a certified educational assistant who is assigned a homework support group. Do you have anything like this here, like a place students would go to complete homework or anything like that? Okay. This is room 209. It's every day at lunchtime. On Tuesdays and Thursday afternoons, sorry to the administration here, they're not going to like me after this. I, as the vice principal, ran a homework support session when it wasn't volleyball season, because otherwise I was coaching my son's team, but outside of volleyball season, I ran it Tuesdays and Thursdays with somebody else running it during volleyball season. Saturday school, we try to run a support school every 8 weeks or as necessary. And lastly, we try to contact parents about this. So I want to tell you a little something about these students. How do I bring support to a homework room when it's after school and I'm not going to lean on teachers to be there? I'm like, who could I find near school? I teach a leadership class. Leadership class is populated quite largely with students who are strong academically. Many of them want to go into education fields. Some are talking about medicine, sciences, whatever. I said, would you like to get volunteer hours helping some of our students who struggle with organization, struggle with completion, need somebody to explain a math concept to them in a different way or how you might tackle it? So what I did is I connected leadership students. Here's an example of one of my leadership students working with somebody who just needed to sort his binder out and make some sense of it. I provided a warm, predictable environment in which to complete assignments and projects. A former student of mine and volleyball player I've coached runs one of the large grocery stores in Penticton. I called him up and asked if he wouldn't mind supporting our after-school homework club. He said, sure I will, with drink boxes and some cookies. We provide hot chocolate, cookies, and fruit, especially in the winter months. Now, I have a separate keynote that I've been working on called What Educators Can Learn from Advertisers. Okay? So I have a quick question for you. It's going to be a little bit like word association, okay? I want you to tell the person beside you as fast as possible what this company sells. Okay? What does this company sell? What does Michelin sell? Hey, mine people said tires. Nice, well done. Anybody else listen to Terry O'Rourke, who's under the influence though? Terry O'Rourke has a different opinion of what Michelin sells. Go ahead, Bill. You listen to Terry O'Rourke? Okay, have you heard what Terry O'Rourke talks about with Michelin? They do not sell tires. At least according to Terry O'Reilly saying, what was Michelin's most successful ad campaign ever? It starts with because. Because so, safety. They just happen to pedal tires. That's what they sell. He says Nike doesn't sell sports attire. Nike sells motivation, self-improvement. It just happens to be the product they sell. So guess what? What does Homework Club sell? I thought when we started this program that it was going to be about leadership students helping other students get their homework done. A bit like I thought I was selling tires. Why don't you turn to the person you've been welcome to speculate this is gonna be guess what they actually sell? And maybe I've told you enough. Leadership students drop by after school, help students with their binders and stuff. What does Homework Club sell? You get 20 seconds to see what the next word is coming on the screen. Okay. The slide's already built. I can't change it. There's going to be a word. Michelin sells safety. Homework Club sells. I've got community on the floor here. Sorry? Confidence? Connection?
Tires.
Tires. Alright, so here I'm going to change the photo. And it is, I would say, if there's anything we were selling, this connection. That, here's what. There was a teacher, biology teacher, by the name of Scott Harkness. He had been dropping by for a while. He's often after school anyway. He poked his head in, he knows much of the students, and he said, I've been noticing something. At first, the hardest part was getting some of our most at-risk learners to come to Homework Club. Perhaps you can fill in this blank. After a few weeks, the hardest part was getting these same at-risk learners to found this, that homework became the medium, became the vehicle that we could connect students from leadership with making positive connections with students who were least connected in some ways of our school. And it was just a really remarkable thing to see. And at the same time, we were doing something to support some of those learners who most needed it. So, it's 3:29. I'm going to finish with an account of a student that I wanted to end on. And there's lots in your handouts. There's two things I wanted to share. One, for all the trades teachers, elective teachers out there, I have a pretty good idea of assessment tool. I'm going to be really fast about this so we can get out of here. Here's Odell Beckham Jr. I think it is. Oh, he's really struggling. There's a spider chart. Spider charts are what the NFL players will have prior to being selected by an NFL team. And in this case, it shows you, compared to all other people who play your position, how, compared to them, how strong are you? So just so we understand this, Odell Beckham Jr. is in the second percentile compared to all other wide receivers in the draft. He's not very strong on the bench press, but compared to all other wide receivers, he's very, very fast in the 20-yard shuttle, where he's in the 96th percentile. So what this does, it almost gives you a fingerprint of an athlete's ability. It got us wondering, could we adopt this into student self-reporting in some way? So what we've done is we've built a spider chart for our foods program. So are students going to take risks in their food presentation, designing and planning, prototyping, making, testing, and plate presentation? Be super curious to think about where, either in PE, in some of the trades programs, what would it look like if students began to sketch out and perhaps even using a scale, draw where they belong? So, we are very, very new upon this, but it's the student who reports how they're doing, and the teacher simply checks off agree or disagree. And if it's disagree, let's have a conversation about this. I'm kind of An English teacher who is trying this gets her students to do this sketch on their writing, their reading, their communication, and then at the end of term, at midterm, they self-report using a spider chart. So this is brand new for us. We're just exploring it with our language. But this is what it looks like. And I believe my greatest challenge is, and the student continues on with that. So what I like to do is I like to end, if at all possible, with student voice. So I just want to introduce you to a student that had a massive impact on me, and certainly had a massive impact on my last project. And here he is. So his name's Xavier. Xavier was a grade 12 student at the time that I shot this video and these pictures. And what I was doing is I was tracking down students who had been in my class in grade 9 and 10, and I wanted to ask them years down the road. So they were in my class in grade 9 or 10, and I haven't seen them for 2 years. They're about to graduate. I wanted to ask them about self-reporting. Remember self-reporting in grade 9 and 10? How do you feel about it now? Do you have any reflections on it? So I'm filming Xavier, and unfortunately, I press stop on the video camera. I still have my audio recorder running. I like to record audio separately and on my camera so I can choose which audio stream to use. And thankfully, that was still playing. It was right when I pressed stop, he said, "And another thing I want to talk about." And my camera wasn't running, but I did catch the audio. Xavier, 1 month away from graduation, says, "I remember my grade 9 report card. I got an N for effort." And here's what he says about it.
In grade 9, man, I got an N on my report card. And so I think my buddies did, but like, we came in there, like after school, we come in there, have lunch and stuff, and like, I guess she figured that, like, I didn't get a great mark in that class either. I got it like a 50 something, but I got an N, and I thought that was kind of unfair. And she never asked me like my part. I'm like, why I was like not doing well, or why she figured I wasn't putting in full effort.
I still didn't learn from my errors. I pressed stop on that because he puts his backpack over his shoulder and he heads to the door. And when he gets to the door, he stops. And he turns back to me and he says, like, when it comes to reporting my effort, like, why don't they ask me? And he says, anyway, have a nice day. And I sat there thinking about that, going, why don't we ask the one person who's probably in the best position to report on their effort, why don't we ask them? So one of the latest things we've done is this. Whatever you wish to report on, including your behavioral three areas, I'd encourage you to welcome student voice. They may be accurate, they may be inaccurate. I talk about that in my book. There's something we can learn from inaccurate reporting from students. That's their viewpoint. I think I'm a really good student in here. No, you're not. This is a really good conversation to have right now. It's an inaccurate report that you can use to your benefit. I do it in athletics all the time. Go to my libero in volleyball. How do you think you're doing? I'm the best passer in the league. Let's talk about that. I think that's maybe one of the problems. If you think you're passing that well, and you're not really. Okay? So, whether it's personal responsibility, self-regulation, collaboration, what's your goal, how to go, students have the ability to fill this in at reporting time. And most recently, we thought there was a little less judgment if it's tree rings. So what size of tree do you believe you are in that area? Are you a young tree or are you an established tree? And this has definitely been some, I think, a positive contribution of having the Penticton Indian Band near us and just bringing in some of these themes that are just a little less linear and box-like and a little more circular. So this is something we're trying to do. So it's just an avenue for students to self-report. So in closing, which is right there, elevator. I've been thinking a lot about my elevator pitch. And today my elevator pitch for coming in here was to try to give a pretty good idea of what an assessment plan might start with, from purpose, all on the floor to ask. So if I have an elevator pitch, I would encourage anybody to come up with one. Remember we started the day way back when with that piece of paper folded four times? What's your purpose? What do you believe? How do you act on those beliefs? That's where I think Simon Sinek is on to it. Before we're ever going to figure out what we're doing and how we do it, we need to figure out why. That's the most important question. And there's so much on our shoulders coming out of COVID with students who have gaps, and we're talking about levels of stress and anxiety today at lunch. We have a lot on our shoulders. And I don't want anybody to think I came in here today saying, you should do this. It's more, I hope it's come across this way, that I'm sharing some ideas of what I think has worked well for me and what I'm trying to develop. So anyway, if somebody stops me in the elevator and asks me what my elevator pitch is for assessment, I'm going to say this. In every area of assessment, I will engage and empower the student by offering things like student voice, choice, self-assessment, and self-reporting. So I really hope that that's shone through today. And it's never lost on me that you invest a day in me right here. Like the whole staff says, this is your day. So I consider the